Welcome back, everyone. For today's video, we are going to be looking at some games that you guys, the subscribers of our channel, have submitted via a community post. Now, going forward, I do intend to focus on specific openings when I do these sub games and take a look at them. So for today's video, we are going to be looking at the Great Karokan Defense. Now, before we jump into this game, we have between subscriber Matt and No Name, there is a comment attached to it, which says, I saw a video of Dania explaining the Karokan fantasy variation, so I tried it, and it worked great. I was white in this game, time control 5 plus 0, approximate ratings about 1200. So let's jump right into the game. So we start with e4 here, we get c6, d4, d5, and now f3, which is the fantasy variation. Now, at a beginner level, there are a couple of pitfalls, a couple of things that I would warn you about to be aware of. The first thing is obviously after pawn takes e5 here, that you're aware of this idea with queen to h4 check, which attacks upon an e4 as well as the king on e1. If you're aware of this and you know to play knight f3 followed by bishop c4 and castles, with the quick development, it should be pretty straightforward. Additionally, there are two other lines that you do have to be aware of, even if you're just starting out. One of them is this line with e6, same idea that if you play a random move like a3, there's takes, and queen h4, checking the king, and again, winning the pawn on e4. So here, you do need to be aware that after black plays e6, you should play knight c3 to guard the pawn, but after bishop to b4, either to play queen to d3 or to play knight g2. This way, the queen h4 move is not as effective. So you have to be aware of that. And the third point, which I want to point out as well, and this probably doesn't apply to beginners, but more intermediate to advanced level, there is this very tricky line with pawn to e5 here, because after pawn takes and bishop c5, black can try to go queen b6 or queen h4, putting a lot of pressure on these two diagonals here. And because you played f3, you do have some weaknesses. Now, white is still okay after knight c3, perhaps even a little bit better according to the latest theory, but at any rate, it's a line you do need to be aware of. Now, mind you, I don't think this applies to beginners that much, but you should still be aware of this move e5. So the game continues with knight f6, which is already a slight mistake, because now after e5, the knight on f6 has to move. Now, if you move the knight to h5, a knight on the rim is dim, and in this case, it is simply dead, because after g4 here, the knight is trapped. You can't go to f6, f4, g3. All of these squares are covered, and if you don't move the knight, you will simply lose it on h5. So knight g8 is played. Now we get f4 being played here by subscriber Matt. Now this move is a touch dubious, but at this level, I'm not going to have anything negative to say about it. If you were a stronger player, however, I would recommend playing bishop d3 for the simple fact that now the light square bishop cannot be developed to either the f5 or g4 squares here. And if black has to play e6 after you go f4, c5, knight f3, knight c6, and c3, you get this great center here. And it's actually very much like a French where black has this bad light square bishop, which is behind the pawn chain. So bishop d3 is perhaps slightly preferable, but again, at this level, I don't really have anything super negative to say about it, because you need to develop. So f4 is played, we got bishop f5, bishop d3, knight to h6, trade, and now knight to f3 is played. Now at a beginner level, again, I don't have anything critical to say, but it is worth considering that perhaps you can push this pawn to e6, because even though you temporarily sack a pawn, black cannot develop this dark square bishop on this diagonal to either d6, e7, or b4. Now this is also worth noting, because this sort of idea can occur in other openings, very specifically out of the Slav defense, which occurs with d4, d5, c4, and c6, and there are some variations like knight f3, knight f6, knight c3, takes, e4, b5, e5, knight d5, and a4, for example, where black should play e6 so you can develop the dark square bishop. But if black plays a move like bishop b7 here, white has a very strong move e6, and after pawn takes, now you cannot develop the bishop on this diagonal either. So just an idea to keep in mind, it's not the only move, but just something to keep in mind if black is trying to develop the dark square bishop, and you can perhaps push the pawn to prevent that development. So we get knight to f3 played here. Now we get pawn to e6, castles, and now black plays queen c7. Now this is a big mistake by Mr. No Name here. What black should have done is played h5 to stop white from pushing this pawn to g4. Again, one thing that's really important, why I stress that you should definitely play multiple openings or be aware of different openings, is because the pawn structures can generally turn out being very similar. Now we just talked about how the Slav defense can have this idea with e6, but an opening that can have this idea with e6, knight f5, and h5 is the modern defense. So one opening that you guys have probably seen me play a lot with the black piece is the modern, which goes with d4, bishop g7, knight c3, let's say c6, f4, d5, e5, black plays something like h5, knight f3, bishop g4, bishop e2, knight h6, bishop e3, knight f5, bishop h2, and then e6. And basically, what's going on here is sometimes white will play queen d2, you can trade, And you'll notice that black is slightly different because the pawn structure is a little bit different, g6 h5, but you have the same chain of pawns from f7 and b7 to d5, just like in the other variation. And you have the pawn on h5 to stop white from playing g4 here. So this is a similar position with the knight and pushing h5, and this is why you do need to be aware of different pawn structures and piece placements, because when we look at our game here, you'll notice that it's actually very similar here. Same thing where black is this pawn chain, the only difference being the pawns are not on g6 and say h5 here. Otherwise, it's essentially the exact same setup. So black should play h5 here, but instead he plays queen c7. Now subscriber Matt plays g4, excellent move, kicking the knight out of f5. Knight e7 is played, and now he plays this tricky move f5. Now f5 itself is a completely reasonable move. At this level, it's a little bit dubious because black can actually capture twice and win the pawn on f5 here. And in order for white to be better, you'd have to play something like knight g5 here, and after h6, apparently if you sack a piece, there's a lot of play. Mind you, this is pretty dank, I'm not going to pretend to understand this, but f5 could be a little bit premature. So f5 is an okay move, but you do have to know exactly what you're doing here. If I was playing this position and I didn't know that f5 is a good move, I probably would try to play something like queen d3 to follow it up with f5, or potentially even knight to h4 followed by f5 as well. At any rate, f5 gets played. Now we have g6. Now this is a big mistake by Mr. No Name. Black should either take and commit to this plan with capturing on f5 with the knight, or maybe playing h6 here to stop white from playing knight g5, because when black plays a random move, after it takes a knight g5 here, the pawn is very weak, but once you guard, I can now go knight f7, attacking the rook, and after rook to g8, I can now go knight to d6 check, king to d8, and then bishop g5 with rook f7 to follow. Black is simply no development here, and white is completely winning. So h6 is a move to stop the knight g5 idea. However, white can still actually prove an advantage with pawn takes, knight to c3, let's just say knight a6 here, and white can go knight to e2, rerouting this knight to f4, from whence it can attack the pawn on e6. So it's just a little idea that I wanted to show, even though it's not particularly relevant. So here we get g6 being played by No Name. Now subscriber Matt trades on e6, plays knight g5, excellent move. We get queen d7, and now he goes queen f3. Now queen f3 and knight f7 are both great moves. I cannot fault either of them. I think it's more just a matter of stylistically what you prefer. Do you like vanilla more than chocolate, or do you like mint more than either? However it is, that's the case here. At any rate, queen f3 is a very good move. We get knight to knight f5 isn't played, sorry. We got bishop to g7 here. Knight f5 is the only move to try to avoid losing on the spot, but after takes and just knight c3, white is an extra piece here, and you should convert this pretty cleanly. So instead we get bishop g7, now we get queen f7 check, king to d8 is played, queen takes g7, queen to e8, subscriber Matt takes on e6, king d7, and now he goes bishop g5. Now again, this is more about style than anything else, but I would be very cautious here to play a move like bishop g5, because in this position your knight is under attack. And so in such a situation, I probably just play check, king c8, and then bishop g5 to keep it very simple where nothing is hanging. Because when you play bishop g5 here, black could take the knight on e6. Now mind you, white is still completely winning after rook to f6, king d7, and rook f7, winning the knight on e7. But why do you ever want to allow this to happen? At any rate, Mr. No Name does not take the knight. Instead, we get rook g8. Knight f8 is played by subscriber Matt. We get rook f8, rook takes rook. Queen is trapped on e8 here. This looks like a pretty clean wipeout. Black takes, take the queen on f8, knight a6, check, king c8, queen to d8, checkmate. So what to say about this first game other than, on first glance, I'm going to be honest, I feel like subscriber Matt might be a smurf, because this is just a really, really clean game from start to finish. Very few mistakes by him. Maybe f5 is a little bit too committal perhaps, but overall, f5 is too committal, and maybe f4, I mean f4 is completely fine objectively. If a GM played f4, maybe I'd be critical and be like, man, this GM doesn't know what they're doing, they should have played bishop d3 first. But other than maybe bishop d3, which is a touch better than f4, and perhaps playing this f5 move, those are really the only two things that I can critique. So overall, a great game by subscriber Matt. Again, I assume he's 1200. If he's smurfing it better, so be it. But really, overall, great game. Nothing but positive comments from me on this game. Really, really clean from subscriber Matt. So maybe you should keep sticking with the fantasy variation since it worked so well in this game. All right. Now moving on to our second game, we have a game that is played between Kai L and Mr. Lee Chesspotzer, rated 2200. Now this was a game that was played between Kai and Mr. Lee Chesspotzer, of course on Lee Chess, hence the name. So the game starts out with e4, we get c6 here. Now, before I jump into the game, of course, players rated 1900 and 2200, so a little bit stronger. We get knight to f3, d5, takes, takes, now we get d4. Now, normally, this position with knight e5 occurs out of the other move order, where white plays knight to e5, knight to c6, and then d4, but it's pretty much irrelevant how you play it. So we get d4, knight f6, knight to e5, and now we get a6 here. Now, this is a pretty good move played by Lee Chess Potzer, because if black tries to trade the knights here and develop naturally with bishop to f5, for example, white can now go bishop b5, check, you block, queen takes d5, queen to a5, check, knight to c3, guarding the bishop on b5, and white is simply up a pawn here. So black has to be a little bit careful, which is why normally if black takes, it's considered a little bit dubious. Also, if you take and play a6, for example, very similar to the other game, white can go bishop to d3, stopping bishop f5, bishop g4 isn't possible either, and after a move like e6, you can now play knight to d2, bishop to c5, castles, knight e7, and then king h1. Let's just say black goes knight c6, f4, castles, and knight to f3. And white is a little bit better here, because if black doesn't do anything, say you play a move like a5, we have a classic Greek gift with bishop takes h7, king takes h7, knight g5. If black was king g8, there's queen h5, threatening checkmate. If you go rook e8, I check, 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 and then this is simply checkmate. King has no squares, so black can't really play rook to e8 here. And if you don't play rook e8, you're just getting checkmated in one, unless you sack the queen, so this would be game over. Additionally, if black plays king to g6 here, for example, you can go queen to d3, check, f5, and now you go queen g3, and black has no good response to knight takes pawn with the classic fossil. So it's just worth noting that this would be very good for white if you reach this position. At any rate, black is a 2200. He does not play this. Instead, he plays a6 right away to stop bishop to b5, and now we get this move knight to c3 played here by Kai L. Now, I don't know how much Kai L studied chess openings or not, but I must point out one important thing. Now, as I think about variations in the Caro Kann, I cannot think of any variation where you trade these pawns on d5 with the knight on f3 or even the knight on g1, where you trade these pawns on d5 and you do not play pawn to c3 or pawn to c4. So, for example, we go back to this position, white can play c4 here, and this is what is called the Panov variation in the French with c4. Black normally plays something like knight f6, knight c3, and so forth, but white pushes the pawn to c4. Or another variation that white can play sometimes is like d4, d5, trading, and we get an exchange variation where white creates the pawn chain. I cannot think of any variation where you put a knight on c3 when you trade. You always put the pawn on c3 or c4. So knight c3 is already a bit of a mistake by Kai L. We get bishop to f5, and now knight takes c6. Now, you probably want to play bishop to d3 to trade the bishops, but here you potentially hang a pawn on d4. Black can also just trade here, trade everything off, and go e6 followed by knight e7 and knight c6, and the pawn structure is slightly favorable for black. So we get knight takes c6, pawn takes knight, bishop to d3, bishops get traded here. Black plays knight f6, castles, e6, all pretty normal so far. Bishop g5, h6, bishop to h4, and now we get bishop e7. And here Kai plays rook e1. Now, one of the things that's really important here is to understand the pawn structure. White only has this lone pawn in the center. Black has a semi-open b-file. He could also potentially try to open the c-file as well. So in this position, the best move to play, and this is not a natural move to be clear, is to play the move knight to a4 here. The reasoning is that you stop black from playing c5, and when black castles, you can now play c4. Let's just say black was queen a5, b3, and rook d8. You get rook c1 in here. And white is threatening to open up the c-file for the rook. Black can't really play c5. If black trades on c4, you take with the queen. And now both the pawns on c6 and a6 are very weak here, so white is clearly better. So you probably should play knight a4 simply to stop c5. But again, if you're unfamiliar with the structure, it's a very, very difficult move to play, and it's not one that I would expect someone at 1900 to find, unless they've played one of two different openings. Now, there's two openings that I'm going to say are either you play the Scotch. One of the openings that I played in my youth was this Scotch variation, and I'll just show it so you guys see it, which is this classic four-knight Scotch here with knight c3, bishop b4, takes, takes, bishop d3, d5, takes, takes, castles, castles, bishop g5, c6 is played here, and now white can play knight to a4. Now, mind you, it's a little bit different because, of course, you don't have pawns on d4 and e6, but the idea is still the same, that generally what happens is you try to play for c4 and rook c1 and open up the c-file here. So it is a common idea in the Scotch, but again, if you don't play a Scotch, you're simply unaware of it. The other variation that you can get something similar in is in the Sicilian. You get knight f3, knight c6, d4, takes takes. You got e6 here, knight to c3, and now black can play a6, takes takes, bishop d3 and d5. Now a little bit different again, white is a pawn on e4 versus d4, but again there are variations here where you play something like queen to e2, bishop e7, and you try to go knight to a4 with the idea of castles and playing for c4 here, or playing e5, knight d7 and then c4. So again, the knight goes to a4, it's on the edge of the board, but there are some structures that are fairly similar. At any rate, back to the game, we get this position with rook e1, castles, and now rook to e3 is played by Kai, and Kai starts to get stuck in the mud here. If you don't understand the concept of knight to a4 preventing black from playing c5 here, it's very, very difficult to figure out what you're really aiming for. So when Kai plays rook e3, his idea is very simple. He wants to go rook g3 or maybe double stack on e1 and play f4 and f5, but you're just getting stuck in the mud. Now Lee Chess Potzer plays c5, which is the best move in the position, because what black does is he gets rid of this weakness on c6, and he now potentially has two open files that he can play on. Rook g3 is played, c takes d4, queen takes d4, and now rook to c8, a good move here, threatening to play rook to c4. Now you'd love to go knight e4 here, but black just takes with a pawn, not with the knight, because if you could magically have it where black can't take with a pawn and where to take with the knight, there would be checkmate, and if not, there would be massive pressure towards this knight on f6. But alas, it simply doesn't work. So we get queen to d2 that's played here, knight to e4 played by Lee Chess Potzer. Very, very good move here, leading directly to an endgame where black's a little bit better due to the pawn structure. Now black could play something like queen c7 as well, or even rook to c4 potentially, but I really do like knight e4 because it forces a bunch of trades. Now here we get bishop takes bishop. White would love to take the pawn on h6, but if you take on h6, after knight takes rook, there's no pin anymore, your queen's under attack, and you're losing a lot of material. Additionally, if you take the knight on e4, I can now take the bishop on h4, and both the rook and the knight are under attack here, and white once again is in really bad shape. So we get bishop takes e7, knight takes d2 played by Lee Chess Potzer, bishop takes queen, rook takes, and now you start to see why this knight on c3 is so bad, because it blocks his pawn on c2. So right off, you can tell that if you were to play a move like h4, black can go d4, removing the knight from c3, and after knight c2, rook takes c2, black simply wins on the spot. So white has to be very careful. Additionally, if you could put the knight on e2 and go c3, for example, white is still a little bit worse, but there are pretty decent chances to save the game. But unfortunately, this knight is in front of the pawn, and that spells doom for white, I assume, in the long run. Get rook to c1 played here, d4, knight to e2 played by Kai, good move. Rook guards the pawn, knight is away from c3, and now maybe you can play even rook d3 to go after the pawn on d4 and the knight on d2. We get e5 played by Lee Chess Potzer, very, very good move. Rook to d3, attacking the knight on d2. Knight to e4 is played here. Now this is a slightly unusual move. Probably if I were playing here, I would play knight to c4, attacking the pawn on b2, but I can understand why you wouldn't play this move, because you figure, well, this rook is on the c-file, open c-file, why would I put the knight in front of the rook when I can just go to e4 and move the knight backwards from there? So that on first glance, that's probably what you would think, and even though I think knight c4 is objectively better, knight e4 is completely fine too. So now in this position, we get pawn to f3 being played. Now we get knight to c5, and now rook to a3. Now, rook to a3 is not necessarily the end of the world. If these were players who were a little bit stronger, maybe closer to IM or GM level, I actually think rook a3 is a pretty good move. But at this level, I think it's very difficult because the rook swings to the side, and it's not really clear what you're doing after rook to c6, because you'd love to go b4, attacking the knight here. But now black can simply move the knight and use this very weak pawn on c2, and the rook on c6 guards the pawn on a6 here. So you can't really push b4. If you push c3, black just goes d3, and he's doing very, very well with the passed pawn. And so the rook just looks a little bit misplaced, whereas if you go rook to d2, the plans become a little bit simpler with ideas like c3 to try and keep pressure on the d-file. Black plays something like, let's just say a5, you go c3, d3. Now you can play knight to g3, and after black plays a move like a4, you can very simply play rook c to d1, and after f6, you can now go knight to e4 here, removing the knight on c5 from guarding this pawn on d3, and white is still worse, but there are pretty good chances to save the game. So I probably would prefer rook d2 at this level. If the player is a stronger player, rook to a3 I think is actually best, but following it up with the correct plan is very, very difficult. So we get rook c6. Rook to d1 played here. Now we get rook cd6. Now this move is a mistake here. I think already here black should play rook to b8, removing the rook from the d file, because now when you attack the pawn on b2, If white plays b3, you can simply move the knight backwards, and c2 is undefended here. Additionally, after a move like rook to d2 and rook c8, now you'll notice that white can't guard the pawn. If you push it, black simply captures with d takes c3 and wins the game on the spot. So you can't push the pawn, and if you lose it, you will lose the game because black is going to end up with passed pawns in the center of the board. So rook b8 would have been a very strong move. I think white has to play rook to b1, but after a move like f5 followed by knight e6 and e4, white is still in a lot of trouble. That being said, Lee Chess Potzer is a Potzer for a reason. So he plays rook c to d6, and now we get knight c1. Now it's worth noting that rook a5 would have been a very strong move here, because now you attack the knight on c5, but also potentially the pawn on e5. So if black, say, goes knight b7, you win the pawn on e5. If black plays knight to d7, now you can actually go c3 here, because after d3 is played, you go knight g3, threatening to go knight e4 or knight f5. Black doesn't really have a good move here. If you could play f5 and stop knight e4, that would be great, but here you just capture the pawn. And if black plays a move like f6, for example, you can simply go knight to e4, attacking the rook. And after rook to b6, rook takes d3, white is winning due to this pin. If black takes the pawn on b2, you go rook d5, double stack, rook b7 here. And now many ways for white to win, but probably one of the simplest is to go knight c5, forking the knight and the rook. And after knight takes knight, rook takes check, king f7, you can just go rook d to d1, and the rook is much better than the knight on c5. So instead, knight c1 is played here. Now the other thing that I want to point out for Kai, and just in general stronger players, is there are a lot of end games where you reach rook and pawn versus rook and pawn, or pawns on the board I should say, or like rook and knight versus rook and knight, where you can actually generally bring the rook from either the a file or the b file up a couple of ranks and attack from the side, or try to push your pawns further. It's a very common theme that does occur in end games, so something to keep in mind if you ever end up with a rook on the a or the b file, and vice versa on the g or the h file, if there are ways to bring the rook up one or two squares and then attack from the side. So it's worth noting. At any rate, we get knight c1 here. Now we get f5, and now Kai plays knight d3, an excellent move here, forking the knight and the pawn, offering black to trade the knights. Now if black trades the knights, you can take with the pawn. Now black is no longer getting a passed pawn in the center of the board here. White also has a two-on-one on the queen side, and you still have ideas like rook a5 to attack from the side. So we get knight d7. Kai plays rook e1, good move, stops the pawn from pushing to e4. Also, you threaten to win the pawn on e5. Now we get rook to c8, and now, ooh, Kai plays knight takes e5. Now that is a bit of a doozy here. So after defending so well for such a long time, Kai finally loses the threat. Now, it's worth noting that in this position, there is only one move that still saves the game, which is rook to e2, guarding the pawn. Because if you were to push the pawn to c3, I can simply take. And now when you capture, we trade everything and you lose the horse on d3. So the only move here that saves the game for white would be rook to e2, because you're still attacking the pawn on e5. And now if black tries to go e4, the big difference is you trade, take, rook takes c2. And after a move like h3, black is still maybe very slightly better here, but the passed pawn on d4 is actually blockaded by the knight on d3. And now this pawn is almost in some ways a weakness on d4 versus a strength. So if Kai had found rook e2, there's a very good chance he still could have saved the game. But unfortunately, Kai plays knight takes knight. And now after trade and rook takes c2, we have an endgame where both sides have two rooks. But more importantly, black has a passed pawn, and he has a passed pawn with a rook behind it as well, which makes it doubly powerful. So Kai goes rook to b3. Now, probably there aren't really many moves here. He could have tried rook d3, but after rook takes b2, rook takes f5, rook to c6, black is threatening to create the ladder checkmate. And when you play a move like h4 and black gets rook cc2, now with the rooks connected on the seventh rank, this probably is winning for black. Nonetheless, this would have been a better try, because after rook b3, d3, now the pawn is just flying down the board, and with the rook on c2 going to c1 combined with d2, it's simply hopeless. So here Kai plays rook e1, we get d2, and now we get rook, and actually no, sorry, after d2, Kai resigns here. He does not play rook d1, because then rook c1 would win the game. Pawn on d2 guards the rook on c1. Now, very, very unfortunate for Kai, because it felt like he was worse, and he defended really, really well up to this point when he took the pawn on e5. Now, it could have been a low on time, could have just been an oversight, not realizing how powerful his pawn was, but very, very difficult after defending so well for the last 5 to 6 moves from a much worse position. Nonetheless, I think there's a lot to be learned from this game. First and foremost is in the opening. No matter how much you study variations, you have to realize that in these Caro Kanz, whenever you trade these pawns on d5, doesn't matter whether you put the pawn on d4, play knight f3, you always, as far as I can recall, you always play c4, c3. I'm trying to think of a line in my head where you do not push c4, c3, and honestly, I just can't think of any lines where that is the case. So first and foremost, when you play the Karo Khan and you do exchange the pawns on d5, you are always playing c3 or c4. Keep that in mind, because when we look at this position here, after white plays a move like, let's just say bishop d3, bishop to g4, c3, e6, you can now put the knight on d2, castles, play rook e1, and everything is very, very standard here. Now, mind you, the position is still very balanced. It's not like white is better, winning, anything of that nature. But nonetheless, this is a better way of playing it. So for the future, when Kai, when you trade the pawns on d5 and the Karo Khan, always make sure, even in this 95 line, always make sure you push c3 or c4 if you're going to trade the pawns on d5. Just keep that in mind, and then you look to always develop the knight to d2 and f3 down the road. So that is the first thing. The second thing I would say is that, again, very, very difficult here to know this concept with knight a4, but if you do have structures where black gets the center and you only have a pawn at either d4 or e4, this idea with knight a4 is very, very strong, and it's very thematic. But again, if you're not aware of it, you're never going to be able to play it, because you just won't understand what the idea is behind it. So just keep in mind the structure where you end up with a pawn at either d4 or e4 versus this sort of mini triangle, that you have ideas like knight a4 to stop black from pushing. And the third and final thing I would say is that in this end game, just being mindful of this position here, what the exact themes are, and realizing that there are moments where you can push the rook forward and attack from the side. Again, not something that I expect a 1900 to understand or find at all, but it's just something to keep in mind that when you do end up with rooks on the edge of the board, sometimes you can move them up a couple of squares and attack from the side. Just something to keep in mind at any rate. So pretty good game from Kyle. A little bit unfortunate they lost this game after defending so well, but nonetheless, there are a lot of lessons and a lot of takeaways from this game that I think Kai will understand and not make the same mistakes going forward. All right, you guys, so I hope you've enjoyed this. These are the two subscriber games that I'm going to be going over this week. I will be posting either another community post or a Google form, so you guys can give me your games and whatever creative openings are played. And I will try to do this once a week, where we review games of our subscribers of the YouTube channel. On that note, make sure to hit the subscribe button below if you have not already, and we'll be back with more great YouTube content in the very near future. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Have a great rest of your evening. Bye.